brutality is part of that, oh, that shock value. And shock is just one of the emotions of horror, right? And so I kind of look for those to affect people a little bit.
What we wanted the project to be was really about looking at films and games and kind of thinking about how we wanted our project to sit within those.
You know, we watch these movies and it does give you a feeling.
It was a lot of fun because there was a lot of research.
When you sit down on the couch or go to the movie theater to watch a movie, you're experiencing someone else's story, and you can feel things by experiencing that story, and it can be very moving, but there is always going to be a distance between you and that character. One of the things that video games does that I think heightens things for storytelling purposes is it puts you in the center of that story. So you are the one performing tasks. You are the one succeeding when the character succeeds.
I think the growth in that is exponential. I mean, I think it's going to be massive, even from where it is now.
Whoever the next George Lucas is, he, she, they, at 13 years old, they have a controller in their hands.
It's an experience that is unrivaled in other forms of entertainment.
There are two movies, Hostel and Martyrs, in which there was a scene in each one that were so brutal that it affected me. Like for a couple of weeks, I'm like, oh, gee, you know, just thinking about it, I'm like, man, that was really brutal.
The concept of brutality is, well, it's certainly useful.
Brutality is a very specific kind of trauma. It is usually senseless. It usually has a visceral, almost excessive amount of violence to it.
They don't pull punches at all in this game. And I was like, whoa, Glenn, Scott, Chris, you guys are crazy.
We wanted to get to something that felt very raw, very real for the player. And that's a fantastic tool for really sort of cutting through the noise in some respects, for connecting with people and evoking that kind of almost like lizard brain reaction of terror and fear to what's happening on screen.
You know, conflict is drama. And physical conflict, aka brutality, is the most primal form of conflict. And it's something that everyone can understand.
You have to be very, very careful with it. You know, you see somebody come along and chop somebody else's head off, like Tom Savini did in Friday the 13th. Well, that had never been done before. It became like a magic trick. You say, how did they do that? But it's gone. And then you go forward.
I do the same thing a magician does. A magician is trying to make you believe that what you're seeing is really happening. Well, that's what we're doing in the movies.
We do have a lot of parts coming off and dismemberment and all of that. We have bones showing off, but it's not like, oh, this game is about showing the bones. No, I think it's about the combination.
This is really about survivorship. I've got a bone up. I actually have to match that level of violence. I have to become offensive.
It also so crosses a line from civilized behavior that it lets you know that in this story, this is the world we are in now.
You know, you really have to put your characters through the ringer in horror. If you have a guy trying to get from point A to point B, you know, that's a story. You can have conflicts happen along the way. If he's got a broken leg and his bones hanging out, the story's about 10 times more interesting, to me at least.
I'm just trying to give you a chance at rebirth.
In creature design, no matter how fanciful, if you have one toe in reality, maybe, you're going to fare better than if you are doing something that is a complete flight of fantasy.
You know, biophage didn't just happen. It took a lot of like nuances and drawings and sketches and 3D pieces and stuff like that. And then I realized personally, the thing that scares me the most is a deranged human.
When you make a character that is two arms, two legs, a head, two eyes, you're building familiarity into it. Does that make it more or less scary?
There is something a lot more terrifying about being able to look at a creature, seeing that there is a human, relatable side, right? That could be me. You have to come up with the style and what are these creatures? What are the roots of these creatures? Are they aliens? Is it something biological? Is it something that's evolved? You know, you have to kind of set down those roots first.
We want to ground everything we do, so we want people to believe on what they see, and that kind of breaks the barrier on thinking that that is just another game or just like something created.
Glauco's amazing, not just his creative eye, but also just, you know, his mind and the way that he has taken the human form and turned it on its ear, kind of giving you this kind of twisted humanity vibe with bones growing out and teeth growing out and eyes turning into something different.
My favorite, which I played a huge role in that one personally, I had a lot of fun sculpting, is Big Mouth, is the guy that we see in the first trailer, and we see it a couple times in the other demos too. He has a really big mouth, and he has like very long teeth, and you know, there's a lot of saliva and like goo like coming out of his mouth.
I don't know how many versions we did of him. Well, not in 3D, but we probably have about 50 different designs of him.
Yeah, that one is my favorite, maybe for bias reasons, but.
We wanted a two-head that was split in half right from the very beginning, and those are still there.
There are some other ones that we haven't revealed yet that are really, really exciting too. That I can't wait for the players to see.
Our combat experience is really getting close to these creatures, and we show full detail. We don't hold anything back.
A lot of it was picking melee as the 50% of our gameplay. You are very close to enemies. You're always within reach of them, and so you're in danger. That also is a way to show the brutality right in front center stage. So as we're doing these melee hits, you're seeing that reaction. Our camera's close up to the enemy, to you. So you see the arm pop off, you see the blood.
Our gore system plays a big role in showcasing brutality.
It's basically a system that scales through enemies, through environmental hazards, and basically allows the enemies to get dismembered, to spawn blood, to have the deaths.
Like if I hit someone with a bat, stun baton, like how's that arm gonna fall? If I shoot him in the head, like is it going to explode?
We have a lot of tools built into the system that we can, you know, achieve all of these different things.
Oh shit!
That's the direction that we wanted to take. So in that vein, we just went to the supermarket and we were buying a bunch of different types of meat, something with more fresh, more red, something with more fascia. Fascia is the tissue that covers muscles.
We've worked very closely with Jorge throughout the process.
He's so passionate. What he did was he bought a light box and then he put the chicken breast on the light box and it's actually measuring lighting values, physical body values from it.
We bring the meat into here, into the studio. We place them on a light rig and we just make the lights spin. And we basically have an image for every single light direction. And that allows us to understand how this tissue is reacting to light. So we can understand how to actually replicate that in the game.
His passion and dedication, I have not seen anywhere else.
So we went to actually pierce our finger a little bit to get some blood in there. And then we actually recorded how the blood will change over time to understand all the range of colors that blood can have, from very fresh to, you know, how it looks like after 45, 1 hour. And we have that, we made that available for artists as reference.
Jorge has definitely pushed a lot of boundaries when it comes to, you know, fidelity and visual improvements.
He is a spectacular engineer.
The dodge system is very important to our game because it really separates us from a lot of other games in the horror genre.
What that is if you hold left on the left stick while an enemy's attacking, you will dodge their attack. And if they come back again and hit you again, you have to hit right. If you don't have the rhythm right, then you will get hit. The other thing it allows us is our AI is relentless. They will not stop coming for you.
So if you shot them in the leg, you blew off both their legs. Well, that doesn't mean they're dead. Now they're crawling at you. And if they're crawling coming at you, if you can't shoot them, well, hit them on top of the head. Boom!
So we are building this world like full of fear, full of horror. And then when you fight an enemy, you get a satisfaction of like ripping off the enemy's head. It's just really trying to enhance that they are very brutal with you. You can be brutal with them, but they will be brutal back.
It shows consequence, right? You don't only see the threat, you can really understand what's gonna happen if that's gonna be reaching to you and it's gonna be defeating you.
And that's where we have a lot of fun because we want the player to feel like, oh man, like, did I just die like that? Like, oh, this is horrible. And like, this is so disgusting.
We've got some real cool death scenes for Jacob, really special.
It's really about seeing what happens to us when we lose against creatures. We show every single detail, and that's what really drives that experience for us.
Most games don't reward you for dying. They just give you a nice you are dead and then take you back. Now, we want to even reward you for dying. We think that's fun to do. It's a little bit of light relief in a failure moment, and we think they're very kind of collectible from the player point of view as well.
I'm looking forward to the YouTube video supercut of all of our deaths, because I'm looking forward to that, because I don't think I've seen them all back to back, and just looking forward to that video.
One more.
We want to be scared shitless without suffering the negative consequences of it in reality. Our mind wants to understand the world in a greater sense without putting our bodies in danger.
We handle it better when we can find significance. We can find meaning in it. And good storytelling will help us find that purpose in really straightforward ways.
Characters striving to succeed against all odds. I mean, that's really the secret sauce of storytelling. And horror does that, I think, better than almost any genre. And brutality is a huge element to that.
Callisto Protocol will, in fact, scare the pants off of all of us. There will be no more pants.
What is fear?
Fear is such a basic part of who we are.
Where is it created?
Atmosphere in a game like this is everything. It's terrifying, but it's beautiful.
And how can we use it?
With horror, there's no rules.
Glen Schofield and the developers of the Callisto Protocol invite you to join them and some very special icons of horror.
I think it goes back to the earliest times around a campfire.
The perfect horror experience is something that scares the piss out of me.
Think of it as a roller coaster.
I want it to make me feel things. I want it to startle me.
They're all magic tricks. That's what we're doing in the movies.
As they discuss crafting the perfect horror experience.
The five tenets of horror for the Callisto Protocol are brutality,
atmosphere,
tension,
helplessness,
and
humanity.
The Callisto Protocol is mastering horror.
The tension in the game is key.
Well, when you think about horror, you know, it's not just sort of an endless series of jump scares one after another.
Tension is built in the moments where you know something is coming, but you don't quite know what it will be and where it will come from.
And then that release, whether it's a scare or not, right? You have to be on your edge of your seat because, you know, you never know. Are we going to scare you then?
Players want to have moments of success. Players want to have moments where that tempo is changing. So that adds to the tension, it adds to the suspense, it adds to the unknown.
It's about blowing air into the balloon, making it bigger and bigger. So when there's finally that moment of release, that burst of horror, the jump scare, we get as sort of big a reaction as possible from the player.
That kind of tension building is similar to film and TV.
If you can, you know, work on the anticipation of the audience, if you can play their anticipation against them, that's another way to build suspense and to make things, you know, more terrifying.
Most people want to avoid or get out of a feeling that's so intense and dreadful. In fact, our natural response when we feel an intense negative emotion is to find a way out of it, make it stop. Those of us who are willing to tolerate that peak are actually kind of more emotionally intelligent when we know eventually that's going to dip out. And those folks that interact with the game for prolonged periods of time are better able to be in control of emotions during that tension.
So atmosphere in a game like this is everything.
Atmosphere and mood is very, very important to the success of horror, to building suspense and to set the stage for what's coming.
It's so critical to kind of creating that experience, that sort of visceral, sort of emotional reaction.
Alien, the spaceship. You know, you're a gazillion miles from home, and if you believe what's going on, you're with them a gazillion miles at home.
To me, that movie is one of the best examples of atmosphere. You're treated to a lot of cool visuals of the environment, and, you know, you get to know this workaday world of these, you know, space truckers and what their spaceship looks like, etc.
What does atmosphere mean? It means lighting. It means the space we're in. Is it wide open? Is it tight and claustrophobic? What are the sounds we're hearing?
The atmosphere almost informs you of what can happen to you, what will happen to you, what is the overall attitude and the place that you're in.
So when we think about sort of our environments, the mood, the atmosphere, it's all about building that tension.
I think that what we're talking about is vulnerable people and a place where there is a great deal of jeopardy, which they may or may not know about.
So what happened to the original colony?
The big word for atmosphere, I think, is immersion.
I want to feel getting spooked while looking over my shoulder. I want all of that. I love it all.
I think that's the beauty of the whole gaming world, is that you are truly immersed and you sort of control your own destiny. And this one is, I mean, the guys that made it, I was like, are you okay, man? How did you think of that? And what went through you? Like, what was your creative process to think of that? That is unbelievably scary.
The design of the prison and the overall planet and just the environment is a pretty deep process.
We probably put half of our resource just on environment design into getting the right atmosphere.
starts with our concept team. You know, we'll throw kind of just a bunch of general ideas at them, like, what does Gempop look like? What does Solitary look like? What does the surface of Callisto look like?
I think of design as like a pyramid where you lay down a big foundation of lots of different ideas where you try to be as disparate as possible with what you're showing so that the director can go, I don't like that, I don't like that, I don't, ooh, but I like that, I like that. And then that moves up to the next level, which is a you know, a smaller platform, and then you keep going until you arrive at that thing at the top.
In the beginning, it was mostly just the environment artist and the concept artist talking together, and we would go back and forth of, oh, this would look better, or how about this, what about this color scheme?
And those guys, they're so creative, you know, they find these great references, and then they'll kind of take those references and just turn them into something you can't even believe.
Instead of a mood, but someone else that's like really good at architecture comes in and do some amazing designs, and then we can like take that further, getting different moods, different pieces. It's a lot of back and forth between different concept artists, and I get to learn a lot from them as well.
Certainly, I think we did our fair share of research. So we have influences, Cameron, we have Kubrick, we have Ridley Scott.
Our art director, Demetrius, and I spent a lot of time like finding imagery and stuff that we would kind of throw their way, like, hey, you know, we're thinking we need some sort of a futurized panopticon area inside the prison, or we need to futurize, like, what does Solitary look like? Like, we want it to be darker. We want it to be more brutal feeling, just something that is just terrifying to walk through.
We want to make you afraid of opening every door. You know, why are all the cells empty? You know, that sort of thing, right? We want you to think a little bit as well, right?
When we were doing the research, some of the stuff became self-evidence. When we were designing the creatures, mutation was something that we were putting forth. And then we were designing the environments to match that. We thought, oh, what matches mutation? Oh, what's a technology that matches mutation? There's something called generative design that's for taking man-made objects, throwing it through AI, and it mutates it into a new design. But what comes out looks very alien and not man-made at all. So it was a perfect match for what we were doing with the creatures.
And so we'll go through a few revs of kind of like designing what the lighting scheme would be like, what the color scheme would be like.
They didn't have a clue what was going on. Things are changing.
To come up with the color palette, we actually went through the psychology of color, emotion of the colors, as well as to actually referencing a lot of sci-fi horror movies.
Yeah, the emotional color is an interesting thing. You know, I didn't really think about it before. And, you know, working with lighting and the team, they sort of introduced, like, you know, we watch these movies and they put colors into scenes that we don't really think about.
One of our areas is a very kind of wet processing area. And so we deliberately use greens and yellows and browns in those because they are colors which emphasize disgust. And so we want the disgust to come through as the underlying fear element in those areas. And we play around with color space theory all the time through our very sophisticated lighting system.
Combining that with us trying to tell the story of what's happening in each one of these spaces, using materials, using bloody handprints, following a trail to like someone who's lying there on the floor. Combining that with the color theory, it provides a very impactful experience, I think.
Asim, our environment director, you know, he has guided our environment team in building these great spaces that not only are just beautifully horrific, but also really compelling and really fun play spaces that you can travel through and want to explore and want to understand by looking at your environment what happened here.
There's a lot of different ways to go about it, right? High contrast, dark areas, gross spaces that you don't want to be in, right? Makes you uncomfortable, and lots of blood.
Each space should make you feel a certain type of way. So going along with, okay, how do we make the player feel isolated? Well, that's gonna be a totally different kind of feel. It's gonna be made out of different material. It's gonna sound different when you walk around it. Or how do we make the player feel trapped? That's gonna be another kind of environment. So it's going off of what we kind of know and then making it fit into kind of that world and how we wanna make the player kind of feel in that moment.
Confusion is an important part of horror, and providing information, maybe misinformation or taking away information or making information abstract. And we can ramp that up or dial it back.
I mean, if it was brightly lit, you feel safe, you know. You're like in a hospital, everything is white and sanitary. But in the darkened basement, you can't see, even peripherally, what might be coming up at you.
One part of tension is what's around the corner. A lot of times we're designing very claustrophobic places in concept. We kind of are casting shadows that could possibly look like some monster hiding around the corner.
Glen wanted to create different entryways for the monsters to come out.
I think that's why it's really good that this is a third person thing. You know, you need to have a sense that there is a back and you can't see what's behind you or what's beyond the frame to the right or the left.
It's not just gonna be, you know, one door opens and they're right there. It's coming out from different vents and pipes, and sometimes you hear something in the background and you don't notice it, but then you do as the audience member.
In the 50s and 60s, there was a filmmaker by the name of William Castle, and he understood that enhancing shock and fear could be more fun.
I love William Castle. I'm very attracted to those kinds of larger-than-life personalities, people who are, you know, they may be doing something cheesy and, you know, low art, but they're pushing the envelope there.
He developed this thing called a percepto buzzer. He would have these buzzers in seats go off while the movie was playing, probably during points of tension. This was essentially shocking moviegoers, but it was also very exciting for them.
The new PlayStation controller is amazing, right? It's the combination of being able to feel your heartbeat and the footsteps and everything around you.
And so that puts it right in your lap, in your hands. And so we've been able to amplify everything the same way with the buzzers under the seats. We can buzz you. And on the flip side, on some of the kind of body gore stuff, we can feel a bone breaking when you lop it off and stuff. And it's that type of stuff that makes you kind of winch a little bit. It's really satisfying.
But then being able to have the speaker built into that controller as well, it kind of gives you a whole new tool in your toolbox. You know, like you could be walking down a hallway and hear whispering and be like, well, where's that coming from, right? And it just kind of trickles out of that speaker. You know, be able to kind of use that to build atmosphere and tension. It's like a kid in a candy store with stuff like that for a game like this.
Using elements of sound in order to create fear is, I think, brilliant.
You know, not just the sounds of the creatures, which are terrifying on their own right, but the sounds of the environment and the music and the part that plays.
Cameron told me that he felt that 40% of the visual impact of any given shot or image is sound. And that's a substantial proportion.
Audio plays a huge role in this, in supporting what otherwise is just an empty hallway. And the ability to engineer horror is a lot easier, in my opinion.
You know, being able to walk down a hall and just hear something, even if you can't see it, hear something walking, or hear something fall, or hear something scratching, and not knowing what's gonna happen. Those are the type of things that can send a shiver down your spine without having to see anything at all.
I gotta say, Glen spends an amazing amount of time focused on the audio.
The music to me is 80% of the audio. You've got to have this music in which you're tense.
Making people feel scared is kind of like what we're hired to do on this, right, guys?
We We've done a lot of things with our apprehension engine.
The apprehension engine is something that Hollywood has used. It's brand new. It's this crazy invention, right? It's a weird looking thing and it's got metal on it and strings and stuff. And the sounds it makes are just awful.
There are only a handful of them built, and it's got a variety of things that you can do with it.
For me, the apprehension engine is, it's like a chaos playground.
Got sort of this core box, and there's kind of a three-string kind of cello component.
The most basic thing is it's got a reverb spring in it. You can just flick it with your finger like this and make the loudest noise you have ever heard. It's so disturbing. It's in Dr. Sleep, actually, several times.
It comes with a little bow, and with that, you know, there's like these rulers that it has, and each one is a different length, so you can get different pitches and bend the rulers.
As if that wasn't enough, then it's got basically a hurdy-gurdy built into it, and the hurdy-gurdy can be played either with a slide or you can play individual notes.
I think I watched YouTube videos to figure out how to even put it together because the instruction manual is really minimal. And once you start playing it, you realize you're like, oh, well, it's just gonna tell you what, you know, you're gonna just react with it, and there's no like right way to play it. And I think it made so much more sense after spending some time with it. It's like, of course, yeah, it's just like whatever you put into it, it's gonna sort of give you that kind of like weird tension vibe energy back, and it's just gonna create this kind of like feedback loop of hellscape sounds that come out of it.
I'm sure this has been done, but I feel like someone needs to do like a Hollywood Bowl show where it's just like one individual up there, and it's just, you know, act one is, you know, beautiful sounds, because you can get some interestingly beautiful sounds
haunting.
And rhythms out of it. Yeah,
haunting.
But then act two would be, you know, everyone, it's time to go home. Like, let's get aggressive.
Act two.
Every project, you're trying to make it is fresh and unique and something people haven't heard before. And it makes it really, really challenging, but also incredibly fun too, because, you know, it's great to do crazy things that people haven't heard as much. And you get away with that like crazy in the horror genre.
Having the creative freedom to be experimental, like no boundaries, it's so freeing on it, you know, especially with an instrument like this. Like, not many other projects would be cool with it.
Knowing when to use those tools, I think it's key to sort of manipulating, you know, the audience.
I mean, it is just amazing the amount of audio and the amount of layers and the amount that the player feels like this is a real world.
I think if we're able to connect to the point that we can make our players jump in their seats, we are on a good path.
It's terrifying, but it's beautiful what they created, this world. I mean, I love the sci-fi outer space aspect of it, you know, and then the intimacy of the prison and all the stuff that happens within that and how they designed all that. To me, they created this world that is awesome and also very scary.
I want the quality of the content that we're delivering to be on par with any film.
Callisto Protocol will, in fact, scare the pants off of all of us. There will be no more pants.
What is fear?
Fear is such a basic part of who we are.
Where is it created?
Atmosphere in a game like this is everything. It's terrifying, but it's beautiful.
And how can we use it?
With horror, there's no rules.
Glen Schofield and the developers of the Callisto Protocol invite you to join them and some very special icons of horror.
I think it goes back to the earliest times around a campfire.
The perfect horror experience is something that scares the piss out of me.
Think of it as a roller coaster. I want it to make me feel things. I want it to startle me.
They're all magic tricks. That's what we're doing in the movies.
As they discuss crafting the perfect horror experience.
The five tenets of horror for the Callisto Protocol are brutality,
atmosphere,
tension,
helplessness,
and humanity.
The Callisto Protocol is mastering horror.
Helplessness and hopelessness usually go hand in hand. They both refer to an experience of being out of control.
As a storyteller, it's important to ride that line between helplessness and hopelessness. You want your characters to be in the biggest pressure cooker situation possible.
Where if you're the audience watching them, oh, you poor thing, how are you going to get out of this? Which is the essence of drama, you know?
No!
But at the same time, you have to keep an element of hope in that story or you're gonna lose the audience.
Come on, I can't.
Yes, you can. We're almost there.
I look at helplessness as a physical condition. Helplessness, I don't have enough ammo. I don't have the right weapon. I don't know what to do here.
It really should be a situation where, based on sort of scarcity of resources, that you feel like, you know, only by the skin of your teeth are you getting through every single encounter.
But it is limited. There's a sense that this is just the situation for now, and maybe there are ways that we could get out of the situation.
You need to have even that little bit of spark of fight left in you, no matter how dire things have become. Once you become hopeless, it, to me, that sort of means like giving in.
Hopelessness is very long-term. It is future-oriented.
Hopelessness is despair. It's an emotion. And the best thing in a horror game is like, I have hope. And then you dash it, right? You just smash that hope.
Callisto is not conducive to hope. That place is pretty hopeless. And if you're able to escape off Callisto, where are you escaping to? What, space? Space wants to kill you more than anything.
So it's a very fine line to make sure that you're keeping your characters as helpless as possible without falling into hopelessness.
Jacob!
For me, you know, the humanity equals the emotional investment that I have in the story or the script.
You go to a movie to feel something, but you also go to identify with a character.
Everything in fiction is all about relatability. So you can watch The Walking Dead and you can see zombies and know that zombies aren't gonna ever happen. That's never gonna be a thing. But the people in The Walking Dead that are dangerous, that they do encounter, that's very real. I mean, a lot of that stuff, you know, happens day to day.
That's another thing that, you know, you can say humanity, but you can actually just replace that word with vulnerability. It's the most terrifying thing that there is.
All of the characters within this game have something that you can relate to. They have a sense of humanity, and so you can actually care about them. You want to survive.
And that's what drives you forward in the game, and that's what hurts you when the brutal things happen, or when you run out of resources and you get that anxiety and that fear.
One of the things I think is interesting is how the main character starts to lose a little humanity as he has to progress, right? Like, as he has to do things that he wouldn't normally consider himself doing. And as a player, you're playing this person not realizing, wow, look at the horrible stuff I'm gonna have to do to survive.
With the Callisto Protocol, one of the things that we were aspired to do was to tell a simple story with complex characters. We wanted to have characters that changed, that grew, that went on an emotional journey, that you followed them along on. They came out the other side not quite what they were at the beginning.
That's what people are going to relate with, I think, the most. They're going to be more invested in the characters, and they're going to want to turn that scary corner and fight for what's right because they're invested in these characters.
A big part of it is having characters that you can empathize with, that you can connect with, that you can feel their humanity, that at their core, there's a sense of sort of emotional realism built into the story.
Most of the time on games, you don't know the entire plot.
Every time we get to rehearsal, we go through every single page of what we're going to work on for the next few days. And Chris and Scott, they explain everything to us.
Because we told the story in such, it was so disjointed. You know, we'd shoot like the end of the game first, and then they were sort of writing it as they went. They'd realize, okay, this works. We need to fix this. We need to, you know, amp this part of it up more. So you're constantly sort of, okay, what happened before this? And what are we doing? And he was amazing at sort of, in Chris Stone, like sort of explaining where we were in the story.
And so what we found sort of early on was that to really deliver the kind of scares and intense feeling of terror that we wanted, it was critical that we have the foundation of strong characters and narrative to build on.
This isn't about escape, Jacob.
What's it about?
Not anymore.
What's it about?
Answers!
Soon everything will become clear. The truth of Black Iron.
The cast of the Callisto Protocol is by far the best cast I've ever worked with on any project.
We don't have a big cast, but they've all brought something to it. They all got into it.
These are people that share our love for the genre and wanted to bring sort of an essential humanity and realism to the roles.
To see a human being, especially portrayed by a very able actor like Josh, you empathize. You put yourself in that position. That actor is reminding you how terrified you'd be if you actually saw that. What would that be like if that was real? And a good actor like Josh can remind you and scare you in ways that you're not prepared for.
You know, Josh is someone that we were lucky enough to work with on previous projects.
We love working with Josh.
Josh was awesome. Are you kidding?
He takes the script and he goes a little bit further. He adds his own humanity. He gets into the character so much that at some point he's going, well, this is the way he'd do it.
I approach it like I do any movie. You know, I really try to be as emotionally invested and committed as I can, even though you're in these crazy, you know, mocap suits with a giant helmet and a camera looking you right in the eye.
Max! Max! Let me go! What are you talking about?
We see their performance because we capture everything at the same time on large mocap stages with cameras on the face. We get to see their entire performance. And I think you can see the quality of their acting come through.
It's nice to be able to have people who have an imagination. For them to be able to kind of get themselves immersed in a scene while they're standing on a stage, it kind of asks something new of them.
The creative team essentially created a playground for us. And for those who are not familiar, the performance capture stage is a bare warehouse.
You don't have that many props.
No costumes, no sound, no nothing.
And you don't have any set around you. It's all make-believe sets that take boxes and say, okay, this is a Jeep over there. This is the pipes stuck together. And that's the doorway into this crazy chamber. And there's 20 dead bodies and four monsters coming at you from the ceiling. So it's all about your imagination. So it makes it much harder.
Open up!
I'd love seeing Karen in the game, because we're both actually huge fans of the boys.
We love the boys.
And suddenly, like, I've seeing her in a full speaking role was fantastic.
Karen brought a lot of energy, enthusiasm. This was the first time that Karen had worked in games.
There's a learning curve that it takes, and she, you know, she learned very quickly.
I remember the first day on set, I was in my full body motion capture suit with the dots on my face and a huge camera right here on a helmet. And it was kind of this weird out of body experience where I had to sort of relearn how to walk and talk and work with my surroundings.
Very quick survey. All right. See Danny down there? There she is. Right, hop down.
Those things don't give up. We better get moving.
You know, some of the other guys, I hadn't worked with Sam Witwer, but, you know, I had heard of him. He's fantastic.
That dude is crazy. Sam is one of the most committed actors I've ever seen. That guy is fearless.
Definitely mad. Capital mad. Sam is a guy that has worked obviously extensively in games and animation. He understands this world top to bottom. He's also a guy that loves coming in and playing.
When you let a bunch of creative people show up and you trust that they have some ideas that maybe you haven't thought of, and you let them push those ideas out there, provided you have someone who's really good at saying, no, that's too much, you're gonna get some really interesting, unique stuff.
5-2-1. Me and you, we got some unfinished business. Yes, we do. As you can see, things have changed.
We go through, you know, a lot of efforts to try to immerse them in the scene as much as we can.
As a performer, the creative team was amazing.
They're very much about the rehearsal process, very much about like giving us as much previs as they can so that we understand the world, they understand what it's gonna look and feel like.
We show them video reference, we play music for them sometimes, we show them imagery.
They have artwork of all of the infected, scary, terrifying monsters.
And you get a little background on it and you understand that, okay, I'm a tough lifer prison dude. I don't stand a chance against that thing. So yeah, that environment of being in the performance capture volume is unique, but I think it's a lot of fun.
Nailed it!
You go to a film right now and you're gonna sit there for 2 hours and you're gonna feel like you're kind of part of the movie, but you're always kind of a little bit detached. You're a viewer. You know, the difference with the game is you are that character. Right, everything you do, you have agency over what you're doing in that game, and you have agency over the choices you make that create that story. You know, so the combination of just that interactive element and where technology is now with the graphics and the visuals and being able to get actual performances from actors versus just, you know, slapping someone's VO on top of some random person moving around, those are very different sort of experiences.
Who did this? And why?
It's like someone's trying to cover up what's happening here. So what happened to the original colony?
All in all, when you're done playing the Callisto Protocol, I hope that you look back on it and think to yourself, man, first of all, I had a lot of fun playing this game.
I think the hope is that you kind of set down that controller feeling a little bit shaken, like you've gone on a journey.
I want them to feel excited, scared, and have fun.
I want them to do what I'm probably gonna do, which is flip it, turn it, and hit go again.
I want them to walk away going, what a ride. I need a nap.
I just can't wait for the fans to play it, and I can't wait to see everyone's reaction to it.
I want people to walk away and just go, that was a good sci-fi horror game, man.
trying to cover up what's happening here. So what happened to the original colony?
Abandoned. Along with the rest of Callisto.
They didn't have a clue what was going on. Things are changing. They're evolving.
Everything will become clear. The truth of Black Iron.
Whoa. Wasn't that something?
Presented by the Callisto Protocol, coming to PlayStation, Xbox, and PC platforms on December 2nd. The secrets of Black Iron Prison are about to be unleashed. I'm Daemon Hatfield, and in celebration of the Callisto Protocol coming to PlayStation, Xbox, and PC platforms on December 2nd, all month long we've explored the elements of what it takes to create perfect horror in a three-part series called Mastering Horror, the Callisto Protocol docuseries. Today we're concluding that journey with a roundtable featuring some horror luminaries, and you'll want to stick around because we're debuting the world premiere of the Callisto Protocol launch trailer. But first, let's meet our panel. From xenomorphs to scary clowns, he's played a role in creating some of the most iconic creatures in cinema history. Please welcome award-winning special effects artist Alec Gillis. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
So, what is your favorite movie monster?
Oh, my single favorite has got to be the original Frankenstein. Perfect combination of Boris Karloff at that time in his life and the genius of Jack Pierce using comparatively crude materials that have never been quite duplicated.
Classic. From Dr. Sleep in The Haunting of Hill House, their music has set the scene for some of the scariest moments in cinematic history. Known collectively as the Newton Brothers, please welcome Andy Grush and Taylor Stewart. Welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Not counting your own, what's the best horror theme ever?
I'm going to have to say Jaws. Yeah, just two notes. That's all you need.
I'm going to go The Exorcist. Yeah, the Mike Oldfield tubular bells.
Yeah, just hearing that.
Hearing that, it's creepy. I don't think it was written, scored for the film, but it's very effective, yeah.
And last but not least, the CEO of Striking Distance Studios and director of the Callisto Protocol, Glen Schofield.
Oh man, it's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
When did you realize horror was your jam?
I was pretty young. I mean, I discovered sci-fi first really young as an artist. I always drew it and painted. But then horror came a little bit later, and it really started, I think, with the sci-fi horror, with like when I saw Alien as a kid, and then John Carpenter's The Thing. I mean, seeing those two mixed together. But I also remember Halloween. Wow, that was pretty young too, and I just like being scared. I don't know what it is.
Well, more on that in just a little bit.
Yep.
Everybody, welcome. Let's get down to the nasty bits. In episode one of Mastering Horror, we focused on brutality and how it's used. Let's check out an example of what we mean when we say brutality with a clip from the Callisto Protocol. All right, well, good thing we were filming this before lunch. Glen, let's kick things off with you. When we say brutality, what does that mean to you, and what is its role in horror?
Yeah, I've seen a lot more horror movies lately that are just more in your face, more brutal. I mean, it used to be that you would say, there'd be five people, and you're like, oh, which one's going to live? Now it's like, which one's going to die last? Because they, you know, everyone dies, you know, like a Rob Zombie movie, man, you know. Everyone dies pretty brutally, but I feel like brutality is more in your face. It's more personal. a little scarier. You know, I've made games where, you know, you're kind of shooting them from afar, and this is like, you know, up close and personal.
Alec, do you have any favorite brutal moments from horror entertainment that really stick out to you?
You know what's funny? I was thinking about it when we watched this clip, is that in my film work experience, we're usually told to pull it back because of ratings concerns. Right. You know? So we're usually doing the less is more approach, and that has been a lot of how I have designed gore effects, or, you know, high impact, quick cuts, seven frames here and there, because I've built some things in the past that just get cut out of movies because, well, because they look like that clip.
Yeah.
And so it's refreshing.
That's a bummer.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I'm going to come work for you.
Yeah.
But it does, what's great about brutality in entertainment is it ups the stakes, right? Especially if, like, a character that is established in a film is established as, you know, oh, this could be like the love interest, or so, and then that person just gets munched. You realize that you are not safe. And I think that's one of the big major values of it.
Any other favorite moments of brutality in horror media?
I mean, that's a really good point about having a connection to a character that then is no longer around, right? And whether you're experiencing it in a film or in a game, you're very invested, whether it's in yourself or in the group you're with or in the characters. And I think that when these things occur that take you out of the game, take your friend out of the game, take someone that you're invested in emotionally in a film or a show, it has an effect on you, like a very concrete effect.
The shock of it too.
Yeah.
That's that initial, like, oh my gosh, that just happened. And I think for us, we're often too, we have to pull it back for cinema as well. And a lot of times it's sort of in your own mind before the brutality, or if it does, like if a shark's in the water and you don't see the actual eating, but you feel it, or the music is sort of describing it. It kind of makes you just twist and turn,
yeah.
You know, versus, you know, maybe in Predator or an Alien or something where the monster comes out of the stomach, or, you know, the knives.
Yeah, like Bishop in Alien. You know that he's not a human, but you begin to like him because of his kindness toward Ripley, and then. And what happens at, like, when he gets, like, basically, like, chopped in half, right?
Yeah.
That's a brutal moment. It's, yeah.
It's intense.
Yeah.
That's a very interesting point you bring up, because those effects that I did design those, the Bishop effects, by the way.
Nice job.
Thank you for getting my email last night when said be sure to mention it. No, but seriously, because of the white blood, we were able to do a lot with that.
Interesting.
Whereas, like, when you say, you know, what are some of the favorite moments of brutality, I go back to Paul Verhoeven's RoboCop, the first RoboCop, that whole sequence where he is begging for his life, and they are gleefully blowing him apart bit by bit. I hadn't seen anything like that in a mainstream movie. Maybe Texas Chainsaw or something like that.
That was brutal, too.
It was very brutal, and that was Verhoeven, like, upping the stakes for the audience.
Yeah.
And for movies thereafter, you know.
Yeah.
It sort of kicked the doors open a little bit.
Have you ever seen Martyrs? French? There was a period of time when the French did these four movies. One was, I can only remember three. Oh, 29 Palms. So, but Martyrs was insane. Like, the brutality of it, like the last couple of scenes, I was like, it affected me for a couple of days.
Wow.
Yeah. And then they did another movie called Frontiers and Inside.
Yeah.
And these four movies, man, were really brutal. And it affected me to a point where, like, I wouldn't put even that scene in this game.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
wow.
It was crazy.
I got to see that.
Yeah, it's nuts.
That's cool.
That. And it's kind of an intelligent one.
Yeah. Was it a horror film, a genre horror, or was it?
You would call it that, yeah. I mean, it was...
It was horrific to you.
Yeah, in a way. We call it torture porn, but that's kind of what it was.
Yeah.
Wow. It was a Russian movie called Come and See. Have you guys seen this movie?
I don't know.
It was the, I think it was from the late 80s, maybe. And it's a war movie from the point of view of a 10-year-old boy witnessing the Nazi invasion.
Oh.
And it's the stylistic basis for what Spielberg did with Saving Private Ryan. Oh. So there's a lot of things happening in wide shots that are very choreographed, of people being herded into buildings and soldiers burning, seemingly burning the building down with their shrieks happening, you know, in one big wide shot. Sort of detached violence, which is a wholly different approach. But sometimes it's those things that are not technically horror movies that, you know, really.
That sometimes happen. Yeah, no doubt about it. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, it's getting harder and harder for creators to keep audiences on their toes. When you're crafting like set pieces in a game like Callisto Protocol, what are your do's and don'ts with brutality, Glenn?
Believe it or not, there's one rule we're not allowed to do, and that's somebody on fire screaming.
Is that a rule you put in place?
I won't say who, but one thing we know, we will get rejected, even in the United States for it. So,
really,
besides that, I guess, you know, we're not going to do children. We're not going to do anything like that. Sure. That's just wrong to me. And believe it or not, I don't like a boatload of cursing in it. It's like I'll have the brutality, but I don't like that kind of, like, you know, keep saying the F word or something like that. But as far as brutality goes, I always ask the team, just be really creative on the deaths and come up with something we've never seen before. And so we allow the team to bring us the ideas. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not going to come up with every idea. Matter of fact, it's better if the team, because you're going to get different styles. So, I mean, we have one where I'm like, I did say, hey, I want the big guy to bite the head off, right? But they don't bite the head off. They bite it to here. And if you look, the tongue is still there. All the teeth are in there. It's if you get the right angle and the right lighting, it's pretty amazing. Wow. But we've turned deaths into a feature. You know, if you're going to die a lot in the game, so let's make it interesting.
That's cool.
Wow. How can music complement on-screen brutality? And what's your approach?
It's interesting. I think that it's been done several ways, but I find it fascinating when people hint at something before it happens, and you don't know why, but you get a bit of a knee-jerk reaction, and it feels uncomfortable. Kind of like early on, like even Psycho, you had those knife stabbing, you know, the dun dun. It was early on in the music, and then finally in the shower scene, that big famous shower, it plays so well because we've kind of been hinted at a little bit. And so I think when that's utilized. Also, I think sound too, like if you take pigs and they're being slaughtered and you sort of shift that and detune it and do things. And people do that with music sometimes, and they'll blend the two. So where it's something about it sounds sort of, I don't know, kind of like it's aggressive and visceral. Mm-hmm. And I find that just sort of makes people feel super uncomfortable. So those are the kind of the ideas that come to my mind.
I think it's easy when you're playing music to be rhythmic and expected, no matter how big or small you are. And I think that we like to play a lot with being unexpected, you know, not like we were talking earlier about when you hear a loop and it takes you out, you know. We feel the same way about, even if it's a gorgeous piece of music or a brutally violent piece of music, if there's structure to it, it can be calming, you know. I mean, the heaviest like death rock you can think of at times could be lulling because it provides like a pace. So I think finding those moments to be unexpected, you know, and those moments to just like a quick, like, you know, right in the neck where you don't expect it. You're, you know, I think
a little jab.
Yeah. Yeah. Musically speaking,
sure.
Of course.
Yeah, of course. Don't worry about it. Don't stand too close.
You wouldn't want to switch seats? Alec, what's the secret to selling brutality from a practical effects perspective?
Well, I think I'm biased about practical effects because that's my art, but I think that what practical effects has going for it just out of the gate is an intimacy and a tactile reality to it. So the way fake blood splatters is exactly the way real blood splatters. You know, our silicones now have that translucent quality that is very much more realistic to it. But those are the technical aspects of it. And really what it comes down to is performance and filmmaking. I'm always indebted to actors that can sell the moment and really feel the terror of it. And I think practical effects gives them an avenue to lock into that terror, as opposed to if it's an all digital effect, for instance, it may be more difficult for the actor to, tap into those emotions. But also in post-production sound effects and music, when I got into my work, I was vaguely aware of those things, but really it's the visuals for me were so overpowering when I was a kid watching these movies. And I've learned since then, of course, that like a scene of brutality or violence can just lay flat on the screen until you get your sound effects and the right music into it and the punctuation of it, because that's your emotional guide. I saw a rough cut of Prey, the Predator film that we did the new Predator for, and I thought, hey, this is a good movie. This is good. When I saw the final product with Sarah Schachner's music to it, it was so emotional and such a beautiful balance between sort of historical drama and horror that those are the examples where I go, oh man, that film composer just made me look a hell of a lot better.
Prey was awesome, by the way.
Oh,
yeah, it was
incredible.
Dan Trachtenberg, God knows what he's doing.
Glenn, you're known for killing your characters in creative ways, and in Callisto Protocol, there's even a trophy for dying in every possible way.
Yes.
We have to know, what's sort of the creative process for that?
Well, I'll start with my chief creative officer who's worked with me a long time, Chris Stone, who he's got a very creative mind when it comes to deaths. But they'll come from anywhere. Like, I know there was a couple of Mikey, like I said, I want him to bite the head off, and I don't give him a lot of direction, just kind of give me that. Some of those we leave to the team. It's just, like I said, you'll get a different style, and you'll get somebody's just thinking completely different, So I love that. We've got some that are just really, really unique. Like one that goes inside his mouth, and then you see his eyes kind of explode, and and people aren't expecting that one. It's almost like a contest who can come up with the worst.
Glenn, do you ever have these moments where you'll get something that you're reviewing and you stand up and you're clapping by yourself? Like, you're surprised by, like, in a good way about something
I love those moments. Yeah, someone will just maybe give me an idea and I'm like, that is awesome.
Yeah.
Right? And that's getting in the game or, keep coming up with it. And it's good to encourage, of course, right? But yeah. We have a dailies room and we'll watch stuff and I'll see things for the first time and I'm like, that is 10 times better than the direction I gave you. So thank you.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. That's awesome.
All right, if you're just tuning in celebration of the Callisto Protocol coming to PlayStation, Xbox, and PC platforms on December 2nd, we're breaking down the ingredients for the perfect recipe for horror with some of the most iconic architects of fear. And stick around, because later on in the show, we're giving you a first look at the premiere of the Callisto Protocol launch trailer. You don't want to miss it. Now, as important as brutality is, it's just one part of the equation. You need to craft the perfect atmosphere and mood to make those set pieces shine. So it feels like an important rule to crafting horror is to get your audience to buy into the situations you've created. How do you go about achieving that, Glenn?
We call it, to immerse the player. And first of all, it's got to be relatable and believable and in my mind, as realistic as possible. So the more that you believe it, the more you feel that you're there, the more intense it gets for you. I don't like anything that will, a glitch that takes you out. So we spent a lot of time on almost every section of the game, like animation. So it's smooth and it's next gen. The character looks real and the environments look really real. With the rust and the dripping and the wetness and puddles and the elements of life and things like that. So you got to get them to believe in the place that they're at. Even if it's sci-fi, that's the part I love, is making sci-fi relatable.
Now, in previous episodes of the docuseries, we talked about the apprehension engine and how it was used in Callisto Protocol. I believe you guys have an apprehension of your own, right? So what is this thing? How do you use it to create atmosphere in horror?
It's roughly the size of like a boot box, a dip bigger than a shoe box. And it's got a crank on it, sort of a built-in hurdy-gurdy. That's one part of it. And then it's got sort of another set of strings you can affect with it, what's called an e-bow, which just basically can make strings, the short version is, it'll make strings vibrate and you can do some interesting things with it. But really, the tricks around it really make it come to life, because I think the gentleman who invented it tells you there are no instructions, because I want you to just mess around with it and play with it. Similar to band practice when you were 10 years old, you know, like, here's an amp, here's a guitar, here's a keyboard, here's a drummer, here, go make music. You know, there's no rules. It's like, oh, we like Nirvana, we like Journey, you just go for it. And I think that the exploration of this apprehension engine is where you find the uniqueness. I mean, there's a lot of other things to it, but it's the idea of playing with this instrument that allows you to come up with some things that you don't set out to achieve. Like, I'm not setting out to play a middle C right here. I'm not sure what I'm gonna do. It's very humbling, actually. You know, you go at it like, oh, I want this like deep, interesting drone, and 10 minutes later, you're dealing with like bouncing sounds through a reverb chamber.
What's great too is that once you have some sounds you like, even a simple bowing sound, you can run it through effects and like a reverbs, and you get these nice long, long drone out drones and stuff, and it's just really beautiful in a haunting, dark, demented way. But yeah, super useful.
Glen, are any of the sounds that we're going to hear in Callisto Protocol from the apprehension engine, were any of them performed by yourself?
No.
Did you want to?
you guys are talking about it. I'm like, why didn't they let me at it? There's probably a reason. I was saying earlier that they created so many. And at some point I said, okay, I need to listen to them and see where. So they send me the file. And there's hundreds. I started going through them. I'm like, okay, we have way too many, but yeah. I could have picked any of them. And they were just weird and haunting. And they did bring apprehension, right? It's the sounds are so weirdly haunting. Like, you'll just have a steady music going along, and then you play one of those. Yeah. And you're like, what's going on, you know? And, man, I love that. Just throw the player off.
Alec, in your opinion, what's the right formula to create atmosphere and tension in film?
Well, there's a lot of different tricks to be used. And you know, if I think about my own evolution as an audience member, you know, when you're a kid and you're, I was scared of a lot of stuff when I was a kid, very overactive imagination. And the things that really would bother me, I mentioned Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, you know, Hush, Hush, Sweet Charlotte, all these movies where it was like strange people just sort of looking at each other and cut, you know, sort of like a novella, a soap opera or something, just sort of like, what are they doing? You don't understand it when you're a kid, but it creeps you up because nothing's happening, but you know that the visual cues are that it's weird. And then later, as you start becoming savvy and you start witnessing things, you're like, ah, that's kid stuff. I don't need that. It's jump scares get me, or you know, the chest burster coming out of out of John Hurt's chest in the first Alien. But the reason that those kinds of things work is that because they have had the proper setup, the proper apprehension, the proper tension to get to that point. And, you know, jump scares are fun and they're fine and they're gleeful, and it's kind of, when they're done right, it's sort of like the director is kind of fucking with you, you know, and it's fun. But you can't sustain on that alone. But when you watch a movie, like, now that I'm older, I watch a movie like Hereditary, and it is all about mood and suspense and tension with a delivery of something really just out of left field and unexpected. That shot where the kid is in bed and you're watching and your eyes are sort of, it has gone from a bright scene to a very dark scene, and you're looking, and it takes you about 35 seconds to realize that the mother is up in the corner of the room, you know, up there. That kind of stuff is absolutely brilliant. And so I think it's as important, I think writers have said that, the words, the black on the page, is as important as the white on the page. It's the negative still moments. Same with sculpture and painting as well. It's there's areas of activity and areas of stillness that frame those areas. And you know, listen, if I knew the answer truly to this, I would have a huge grossing movie out right now. But
you reminded me of a scene in this movie called Inside, which I mentioned a little earlier. And it's dark room, and the woman's just sitting on the couch, and they just are changing the FOV, right? And all of a sudden, you just see the protagonist in the doorway just by changing FOV, and it is so freaky. I can't find a way to get that exact scene in a video game, because we do change the FOV, but you don't know where the character will be sometimes. Mm. But that was like, I love it when they do something brand new. And
it's very interesting. That's a very interesting point, because in a video game, you do not have total control over that.
Only in the cutscenes.
And in film, it's the opposite, where the storyteller gets to direct your eye.
It's interesting too, because I know a lot of directors who are inspired by games, and you know, films constantly are being inspired by games. Do you have what inspires you for, you know, when you're sort of writing these ideas and these concepts? Where are there movies or where does it initially come from, these concepts?
I get a lot from movies. I get it even from I watch so much horror that I get them all mixed up. But there was a scene from, like, I want to say Rest Stop 7, who knows, right? And it starts out with the camera in the woods.
Okay.
And that the camera's just moving. It's moving, and the music is getting, and it comes to a road and a car goes by, right? And you're like, scared the hell out of me. But it was just a car. Right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's cool.
Yeah.
Right? That was a different type of jump scare. And just, it really worked. You
know? Yeah. It's the tension.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And like you said, Alec, the negative space as much as the, you know, the
silence.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes it. There's an interesting, it's a little bit of a tangent, but very related. The composer Ryuichi, who did The Revenant and a bunch of other things, he told this beautiful story about a piano he found after the tsunami hit Japan. And he talked about, he bought the piano, and the person, I'll get some of this slightly wrong, but the general idea was, when he bought the piano, someone said to him, well, why do you want to buy you can buy any piano you want in the world, why do you want to buy this piano? And he said, this piano has been returned to its most original state before humans forced pressure upon it. And I think about that a lot when we're writing music, because you can never have, like, you have to have friction to create waves, you know. You have to, and it's interesting, and you deep dive into that and think about space, right? And space, there's no sound. I mean, I haven't been to space, but everyone has said there's no sound in space. You can't have sound in space. So it's a very interesting concept, like the whole idea of, like, negative space and how it pertains to brutality and horror and what we all do.
I think too, when you've heard something so much again and again, just even just as a constant tradition in cinema, you just start to, the audience just starts to feel it coming. So you kind of have to shake it up and change it up a bit. And with the silence comes, you know, well, when a door makes a loud noise, like, they're expecting, like, this ton of music to just overwhelm them. But maybe it's this door that just swells up, and then it doesn't have to be huge. You can just be some noise. So it's interesting. I think you have to, like you were saying, think outside of the norm and constantly mix it up to get that sort of adrenaline and that shock and awe.
Yeah, it's the challenge of whoever I'm misquoting. Give them what they expect, but not in the way they expect it.
Yeah,
yes.
That's the challenge.
That's well said, yeah.
Okay, let's talk about jump scares versus, you know, a sense of dread. When are jump scares effective, and when should you play the long game, Glenn?
So I don't have rules. I think that you could do a jump scare, and then you know, the player thinks, okay, I got 10 minutes, right? But man, every once in a while, I'll hit you up like a minute later with another one, because you're on your toes. And then you may not see one for 20 minutes, or in a video game a little bit longer, because you can miss them in video games. And that's okay. Like, we'll say, this one's okay to miss because we want the friends talking to each other. But, you know, I'll see it in, you know, social media and they're like, hey, not a lot of jump scares. And I'm like, the truth of the matter, it's about the jump scare because the tension is built up because you're afraid that there's a jump scare coming. Now, you don't have to do it all the time, and you should do it in weird ways so that they don't always think it's a jump scare. But, you know, what's the tension building for? But you guys said something. Somebody said it. We'll scare you at the – I'm not going to bring – early in the game, at a door. And so from then on, we want you to be worried about doors. And we'll do that in different places so that you're like – oh man, now I'm worried about every door. I'm worried about, you know, every console or every locker. But there's stuff in it that you need. So it's, you know, risk reward. So we'll, but tension's really important. I mean, tension is everything, right? And it is what allows us to have that jump scare. It's what allows us to have some brutal combat and stuff like that. But, you know, we were there. I was a trend, and you guys probably know this, is that it's pretty hidden, but just before a jump scare, we'll drop the audio for that 1 second, right? And you barely hear it, that it's dropped. But when it goes to zero, and then the jump scare feels even louder. And got that from movies.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah, 100%.
Can you comment on that?
Yeah, actually.
we're quite familiar with this.
Yeah. Mike Flanagan, who we've had the pleasure of working with, he did that really well in the series The Haunting of Hill House. I think it's in episode 7. There are two people in a car driving, and they're having a discussion, and you're being lulled into their discussion because you're listening to them, and it's kind of quiet, it's kind of intense what they're talking to each other about, and an actor from the back, well, a ghost basically from the back seat jumps out in the middle of their conversation, and it will make you launch your laptop off your lap or right. Scream or spill coffee. Your point, it was all about the sound didn't drop to zero, but everything else dropped away, and all you heard was the road and the dialogue, and then you have this person lunge out at you, and it's very effective to get out of the way. Yeah.
And there hadn't been anything like that for a bit, so you feel like, oh, this is just going to be a conversation. Everyone's just very relaxed, and then all of a sudden, the popcorn goes flying.
Yeah, and it really is to the point of, like, you really do need to bring to a zero. The guy who mixes all of our stuff, Jonathan Wales, is very, very good at understanding that and figuring out the ramp, like where to come down, right? Because it's a feeling. And I know sometimes we'll be in the room watching it go down when they're mixing everything together. And it's let's try this. Let's try a long ramp over 30 seconds. It's fun.
It is fun.
But I've even talking about that 1 second.
Oh, sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
sure.
You know.
Yeah, that, it goes right to zero. Yeah.
And that's pretty effective too, right?
It's very.
It's so subtle.
Yeah.
But it just makes it bigger. And that's the stuff you pick up from people. You're like, what are they doing here?
Oh,
you
know? a little trick. Yeah.
Well, it's also common to have a fake out, right? And then the jump scare.
Yeah.
Right? So you think there's someone behind the door. You open up. Oh, there's nothing there.
Yeah.
Ah, but there's someone over here.
But in a game, being that they're 10 hours, like ours is, you know, 10, 12, 14 hours long. If we did that, we drop it.
Yeah.
Right? And when we get the player one time.
Yeah.
Next time we drop it, we got to do something different.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they expect it.
Because you know, it's like a joke.
Yeah.
You know, you can use it once, twice, but, you know, anything more than that, it's not going to work.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, too, because I feel like that there's certain action movies where the music is so constant and so driving all the time that when something big happens, you're just so used to it being so big so constantly that it's not impactful.
Right.
It's interesting how that works, how you have to create space for it to sort of land with the audience, and it's a kind of a nice thing to know, be aware of.
Well, they've taught me in the audio booths to watch the bars.
Oh, watch the bars,
right?
Yeah.
You know, and you don't want to go to 10 all the time.
No,
yeah. You leave some room for that special area. You know,
yeah.
Alec, do you have any opinion on whether jump scares or a sense of dread are more effective, or do they go hand in hand in horror?
I'm always a mixed bag guy. You know, I think one sets up the other. If you rely on one too much, then you're kind of, you know, undercutting the other. You think of the Blair Witch project, you know, which was masterful setting of mood.
Yep.
And then for me, a disappointing conclusion, because it was all about that was setup of the one thing, and it was amazing, and it carried the day for that film. But I think of, you know, I have four kids, and I think of when they were little, you know, you could like tickle them, and they'd no, and then you stop tickling them, but they're hypersensitive, and all you have to do is like do this, and then they go and they react to this. So you don't always have to do it.
Yeah.
Good point. Glenn, your previous works made hearty meals out of cat and mouse chase sequences that culminate in a cathartic encounter. How do you design those kinds of set pieces?
Man, a chase scene in a video game is so hard to do because the timing, and you don't know how fast the player is going to run, or, you know, are they going to ram into a wall or whatever. So they're a lot of work. And then sometimes you have to have the enemy AI realize what the player is doing and kind of like react to that. You don't want the player dying all the time, but well, we kind of do. They're believe it or not, they are hard to do. And so we've limited how many we do. You can only do a couple in it, you know, you don't. We have one big chase scene in ours, really, and depending on how you play, you'll get caught by a couple of them. So they're not easy, man. But when you get it right, it feels so good, and I think the players really enjoy them. They talk about that a lot.
Sure. All right, if you're just tuning in, we're talking all things horror and Callisto Protocol with our panel of Masters of the Macabre. We're also getting close to debuting the world premiere of the Callisto Protocol launch trailer, but we have two more ingredients required to create a successful horror tale: helplessness and humanity. Glenn, can you explain what helplessness and humanity means to the team behind the Callisto Protocol?
Yeah, helplessness doesn't always mean that you don't have ammo or a weapon. I like to say helplessness is a lot of isolation, desolation. I feel alone, and I feel helpless. Like if you play a co-op game, right? You're not as scared. Yeah, there's somebody alongside you, and so that's why what we try to do is keep the player alone a lot. We will make you feel helpless, and you've got to go around the game and get the right amount of ammo and stuff. But it's really important that the player does feel that I've got to go get more. I need to have more ammo, or I need to upgrade my weapon. And it keeps them on the edge, but it also keeps them going through the game. So humanity starts with, and believe it or not, with I always believed the scariest thing to me is a deranged human, because there's an implicit intelligence, right? So Chainsaw Massacre, any of these guys, you're like, they've got an intelligence. So if you notice, all of our enemies have human elements. They start off with, you know, they look like a human, right? And so, and they do have an intelligence. So, I started, this was years ago in the last game, was, okay, we'll try spiders, we'll try amoebas, we'll try this. And it's like, it's not as scary as a four-faced monster coming at you, right? Because you think it's intelligent. And we make it act a little intelligent. So it starts with the enemies. And then humanity, again, is there's got to be a story. We spent 3 years on the story, just like we did the game. And so there's a real story there, and there's other humans in there that you make touch points with, and they may not die, but it's important that we have the human element and the story element, and because it also makes it a little bit more immersive and relatable.
Well, let's dive deeper into helplessness and humanity in horror media. With humanity, it must have some grounding in reality. How do you find those human elements in a faraway place in outer space like Callisto?
Well, first of all, Callisto is, scientists believe, we picked it because scientists believe that it is the one place in the universe that we could colonize because it has water. So if, you know, if people went deeper, they would see that, oh, there's some science behind it. You know, we have it's a prison. So it starts out and not that we've all been to prison, but you know what a prison looks like. And even though it's a little in the future, we try and bring the elements that you understand. Like, we don't have sci-fi stuff everywhere. It's like relatable. You know that this is this and that's that, even though it has a future look to it. So, you know, we have to bring that believability and the relatability to everything. And, you know, that sort of helps the humanity of it. There's signs around, there's where people slept. I mean, there's bathrooms, there's showers, there's all these things that you'll discover in this world that you go, oh, okay, it's a place where humans lived.
Alec, you have a lot of experience creating effects for creatures from outer space and effects that take place in outer space. Do you approach that differently than if you were, working on something that's a little bit more grounded here on Earth?
Well, I agree with you that I think grounding things in some form of reality makes them more relatable or kind of psychologically more believable. And if you can get the audience to believe in what you're doing or what you're presenting, it's that much scarier. But like a creature like the alien xenomorph, as envisioned by the original designer H.R. Giger, that is a character that is in a way more fanciful. It's a more kind of medieval sort of death imagery of skeletons and bones, and but he's added so many other interesting shapes to it. But it works on a deeply psychological level. And then he's also added the mechanical aspect of it for the biomechanical part that gives it some grounding in our world. So for me, when I saw the film, I thought, oh, well, this creature is a mimic. It's mimicking its surroundings. It can hide in this jumble of technology because, you know, like a chameleon, it has taken, its form has changed to look like its surroundings. So there I bring my own kind of assumptions that is not overt in the story, but I bring those assumptions to it to make it more believable. Whereas a creature like, we did the movie Tremors, where we did the graboids.
Yes.
And that was, you know, in that film, the characters discussed three different possibilities there. They're either aliens or they're dinosaurs or they're, made by radioactivity or something.
That was my favorite.
So we had, no way they're local boys and all that stuff. So we had to come up with something that looked like it could have been any of them, right? It looked like it had to fit that. And that's a very interesting challenge. But it was less about being psychologically disturbing, like an H.R. Giger approach is. So it, to me, it all comes from the story. It all comes from the needs of the script. And then, of course, you know, when you're working with, I've had the good fortune to work with a lot of very talented directors who can either give you a lot of specifics or no specifics, and either scenario is a blast.
But the xenomorph also had, it was relatable to me. I could see the backbone, or I could see some of the things, and it walked upright. Yeah. So for me, it also had an intelligence.
It definitely
does. That's scary.
Yes. And what's interesting too about that character is that it kind of came, that's 1979, so it was coming around that time where you had Friday the 13th, you had these implacable faces, right? Jason in a hockey mask, Michael Myers in an implacable. So and the alien falls into that category too, where it is a humanoid form. I always thought, well, it's because it's been birthed out of a human being, and that's why it's got arms and legs and all that stuff. But we've covered up its face, so you don't necessarily know what its thought processes are. And to me, one of the creepiest things about that is that whatever its thought processes are, its character is driven by the need to procreate. And that's creepy, like just turning a procreation machine. And all the characters are caught up in this thing. It's not necessarily evil. It's just trying to propagate its species.
It was thing.
That's eager, isn't it?
Yeah. You can't design something like that unless you are as twisted as that gentleman was. Brilliant. But that's what I like about it is that you bring these implacable things. You bring your you project onto them. It's sort of like actors. You know, Anthony Hopkins, who does so little.
So great.
You're able to project what you think is going on, and that's. I keep hitting this thing, and that I think is what really can make for a very classic creature.
And the intelligence, like there are several scenes where the alien knows that the human is impregnated, right, or has them inside, and there's a moment, and that is a super creepy moment when you're like. Wait, why? What? Yeah. I mean, going back and you watch, then when you know it's even creepier. But the first time, you're like, what is going on? It's
By number three, we were like, you know, bring the face right up. It sort of scans her and realizes that she's carrying and leaves her alone.
So crazy. Yeah. So that's the intelligence of it scene, is creepy. Yeah.
The two of you, have you scored anything set in space?
Yes, we have.
Extinction Absolutely. Was the most recent one, I think.
Yeah. Extinction, yeah.
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 Does it change how you approach it? Do you think, well, this is set in space, so it needs to sound different than it would, like it wasn't created on Earth or something like that?
Sure, absolutely. I think just with humanity, that since, again, we've worked with some great directors who, you're everything together, you're serving the cinema, the picture, and trying to serve the filmmaker. And I think that, you know, you take a lot of organic elements that are found, you know, like if it's orchestra or a piano or whatever it may be that has sort of a nature of what we're familiar with, and it's humans are playing it, and it's kind of has that, you know, that feeling versus a machine or something. Where in space, you can be a little more cold. It can be more synthesized, or it can be some sort of found sound that is then processed to make it sound more strange, and it's bending and metally or whatever it may be. And I think that having the dichotomy of those two really, really can be helpful when you're, you know, doing something in space and then something with like humans on Earth or whatever, and you want to separate the two. So we use a lot of synths and stuff with sort of the there's a creature, I don't want to give the movie away if you haven't seen it, but yeah, it's sort of a creature, so you think.
Got it.
It was just fun to play with new sounds.
Yeah, and I think even in that, we always like to have like a deep dive, just a conversation just about ideas. And I remember like on Extinction, we were just talking about the idea, well, to get to space, like we can't just like, the five of us can't just like walk out the door and be on the moon, right? There are so many technical things that need to happen for the five of us to be on the moon tonight, like toasting happy hour, that there is a lot of technology involved to get there. But then once you're there, I can only imagine how lonely you could feel in certain situations. Like thinking about Matt Damon in The Martian, right? Like what a great attitude to have when you are, I mean, I wouldn't have that great attitude. I would just lose it, you know? And I feel like a lot of people would lose it because loneliness makes you do different things than you normally would, you know? And like what you were saying, Glenn, about having another player playing with you, there's comfort in that. Like, even if it's brutal, scary, there is a humanity with one person next to you. When you're alone and left to your own devices,
like a composer,
come up with strange and creepy ideas, like you can go to some dark places.
So in Callisto, though, I directed them away from sci-fi in the audio.
Oh.
Like I just said, horror.
Yeah.
Horror. Like when you're making like a machine.
Yeah.
I want it horrible. It should feel uncomfortable. So we, that was definitely, because sometimes a sci-fi can sound a little too happy.
Yeah.
It takes a little of the dread away. Not, Now, a movie like Alien needed it, right? It needed some of that in there. I felt it, and it worked. But with this one, it was just like constantly push horror.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's cool.
And it's tough because, you know, not everybody on the team, you know, knows how to push horror, because I'd be like, even in the art, well, what does that mean? Rusty, wet, drippy, you know?
Yeah.
But by the end, the game, 200 people are all like, yeah, we know horror. It was great to see. Wow.
That's so cool. Great. Yeah.
Very cool.
Alec, what does helplessness mean to you in terms of horror?
Usually, like, you know, it's 10 o'clock at night and I look around and my crew's gone home. I got to do this shit myself. I think with helplessness, you know, it is a key factor in horror. I think, you know, if you look at it from an audience perspective, I think when we go in for, you know, a game, a movie, we want to be put through the ringer. We want to go as deep a dive as we possibly can so that we feel like we've accomplished something. In the case of a game, if we make it out alive. In the case of a movie, when we get out alive as the audience member. So you can't have that unless you are pushed into some, like, you know, bottom of you hit rock bottom, right? And that's the most helplessness. There has to be that moment in a film before the character climbs back out, if they're going to, you know, maybe they're not going to. And I do agree that that doesn't necessarily mean you're out of ammo or you're out of options or resources. It just has to, at some point, look hopeless. I suppose there is a difference between helplessness and hopelessness. If technically you have no help, then you might plunge further into hopelessness. But I think these things are all, at their heart, are cathartic. And you can't really have catharsis unless you push right through the worst of it, you know?
In terms of audio, how do you go about sort of communicating helplessness, a character's situation of helplessness to the audience?
I mean, obviously there's a tonality on the technical side of just more of minor sound, something that has a sadness to it that feels empty. Which there's that, and then there's, of course, the space and sort of the waves and how a listener perceives it with the acting. Because you know, a lot of times you'll get these beautiful actors who are pouring their heart out in a scene, and they're isolated or alone or helpless, and you just have these moments where the music could come in, but it doesn't get in the way, and it just continues to keep. And so the listener feels struggle, whereas if you dictate too much, it becomes sort of melodramatic, and then you're telling the audience what to feel. And I feel like that tends to be the wrong approach. So I think in that terms, that's how what we find is letting the cinema or the game dictate, you know, how you should feel. And so that really allows us to plan those emotions.
Yeah, and you could there's probably more than 100 ways you could score that feeling. You know, you could even take a C major chord even, and just keep playing it over and over and over and over again. And by the time you're 4 minutes into that, you would feel kind of helpless. You know, you would want a change. You certainly would. That's
no
that's
more
one
happiness.
Idea. Yeah, I mean that's one idea. But I think the idea is like similar. It's sort of a combination of what both of you were saying. Like just that, like there's a, you know, you kind of have to get into the weeds of what you're looking to achieve and stay out of the way and get into what the story is, really, because the story is really what's driving everything. And I think that, like, just being aware that you're just there to just kind of support the story in whatever way you can or cannot, stay out of the way or in the way, whatever.
Yeah, like, it depends on the scene, right? Because
absolutely.
We have an outdoor scene, and it's the wind, the snow's coming down, and it's just, he's alone, and we didn't put music, and we just have the wind, and then lightning or thunder, you know, and every once in a while, and it just, he feels alone, you know. Mm-hmm. Here and there, we'll drift in a little bit of music, but it really depends on the scene, like what you guys are saying.
Yeah, one of my favorite episodes of TV that I've seen is their just usage of a thunderstorm, and the actors are all talking. There's no music at all. It's just this thunderstorm happening. And then the very end of the entire episode, music comes in, sort of uplift it up. But before that, there was nothing. And it's funny, because if you would pitch that idea to people, they would be like, oh, that just sounds so boring. And, you know, but when you see it, it's just, wow.
We kind of, they're in Castaway, there's no music until he leaves the island.
That's amazing.
And it's incredible, and you don't really notice it. Like, you're on the island and going through everything. And then when he gets off in that boat, I just got chills just thinking about that music. It's so beautiful. We executed sort of that idea in a movie where a woman is chained in Gerald's game. A woman is accidentally handcuffed in bed, and her husband has a heart attack basically while they're in bed together, and she's left in a cabin and with nowhere to be. And we had this idea with Mike and his producer Trevor to not have any music play until she gets out of the handcuffs. And it's hard to execute that, you know. We had moments where like, let's put music in here, let's put music all over the place, and then it was just like, nope, take it out.
We tried it, so it's
a
process.
Yeah,
I was watching, and I won't remember the name, an Australian film, and they're in the house, and, you know, they're talking, and they're, you know, doing all this stuff, and all of a sudden, then they cut to a long shot of the house. It's at night. No sound. And you go, something bad's going to happen.
Oh, yeah.
Right? It's
oh,
just, yeah. It didn't need any music. It just needed that that silence, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It was like,
yeah.
Great scene.
It's funny you guys mentioned the Castaway, the silentness of the, and I went to see that film in a, you know, mall theater, you know, and a couple people in the middle of the day, and I was struck by that. And yeah. When he's on the island, there's just this constant rhythmic sound of waves, just constantly. And then the projectionist came in and said, "We're going to shut this down because there's something wrong with our."
Oh.
It was a misfunction, malfunction of the thing. I was going, "This is genius," because like same thing happened in Dunkirk, the Nolan movie.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, "Nolan's a genius." The dialogue tracks are now, I can't hear anything. It's like I'm shell shocked. Again, they shut the movie down. We're sorry, this is a mistake. So I'm such a gullible viewer that I
sometimes that stuff works.
It does. Yeah, it does. Well, those are the, like, seriously though, happy accidents, right?
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
Like you realize that you fuck something up, but it's for the better.
Oh, yeah. Totally. Yeah.
How interesting. Yeah.
There was I heard Chris Nolan giving an interview about Interstellar, talking about the scene where McConaughey's blasting off into space, you know, and they're talking about the dialogue that is happening as he's going up, and they're like, "You can't really hear it." And he's like, "No, you can't. You don't care. Like, all you care about is that he's leaving, and you get overwhelmed." And that was an interesting, like, we're used to the version of, like, let's turn off the music, let's mute it. That was an interesting one of, like, let's steamroll the dialogue so you feel like the dialogue doesn't even matter. And I was like, wow, that's a great, interesting concept.
Did you guys, there was that church organ, the celestial organ thing.
Oh, yeah.
There was a mix on that I saw. I know the projector was working well because this was at the Academy and Hans Zimmer was there. But it was overwhelming church music.
Yep.
And again, it was like steamrolling over the, which
yes.
totally was a bizarro choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But like, what a team those two guys are that they allow that. You know, he allowed, Nolan allowed.
Yeah, pretty honestly, incredible.
Very artistic, visionary kind of direction to take. Yeah, it's always
lovely.
And
I think you have to explore it, like you were talking about earlier, Glenn, right? Like, you might have an idea like, hey, we want these mugs to be black, you know, we want to put the logo here. But then someone might come to you and it might be like see-through and you never would have thought that. Yeah. But you're like, wow, that's brilliant.
Or having the score be all more like horror-based rather than science fiction.
Right.
Because it really gives you more of this industrial, this more scare, more tension versus so what's going to happen, you know?
Right, right. Is that, like sci-fi is like, does that sound really fit that gun or whatever? Because it's difficult. So.
Yeah.
Glenn, how does the protagonist in Callisto Protocol, Jacob, represent helplessness for the player?
I mean, he starts off with, like anything like that. He doesn't have a heck of a lot. He gets a shiv from his friend. You know what? It starts with the cover, right? We put him on the cover helpless. And this is a little inside. We were searching for something that I was like, I want it helpless. I want him to feel that way, isolated. And someone came up with an old, if you, I don't know if you're not a football guy, but a Y.A. Tittle, who was a quarterback for the Giants in the 60s. And he's just on the field. The game is done. And he is, it's probably a Pulitzer Prize winning thing. And he's just, helpless. I mean, he looks beat. And we're like, let's take that and turn that into the cover somehow. So he, in many ways, like I said, he's in a snowstorm. He's in a blizzard by himself. He's going through crawl areas, you know, all by himself. And there are times that we'll open it up so you don't feel so claustrophobic, but we'll bring that in from time to time. And then there are times you're going to go through a hallway and you're going to just get attacked and the player's going to die. And we tell him, step back, watch what happens. Take a look at everything you've got because it's not the normal way to get through. So at first the players feel pretty helpless in some of these, but we tell them the tools are there. You know, you just got to think of every encounter as a puzzle. But yeah, we try and, you know, you can't do it for 14 hours,
sure.
Right? The player will just get drained. So there are, and I heard that on Dead Space. People came to me and said, I couldn't finish it. And I'm like, at first I'm like, well, then I'm like, no, that's not good, right? So we have our movies in there, our cinematics, which really help tell the story. They're kind of there for like a, you know, as well. Just
breathe.
Take a breath,
yeah.
And go back at it.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah,
that's brilliant.
I finished Dead Space. It was great.
Oh, good. Thank you.
All right, last question for the group. Why do we enjoy being scared? What is wrong with us? Alec, you want to take this one?
Well, human beings, you know, as human beings, we all search for meaning in life, right? And I think particularly in our present culture, you can see we have everything. We have everything at our disposal. We have all these solutions to the world's problems are at our disposal. We can't get our shit together collectively to do it. And I think that this is on a personal level as well. I think that we all need to be reminded that we're alive. We want to feel what it's like to be alive. And fear is one of the most powerful emotions. So you want to go through something that you know you're going to survive, but you're hoping that you will come out of it with some sort of experience that that gives you a little bit more tools, perhaps, to face when a real life horror comes. And we all face it at some point. You know, nobody gets out alive. So you've got to prepare yourself in some way. And I think that horror and fear is really very valuable to sort of preparing us for that and conditioning us and maybe either giving us wisdom or armor, however you want to look at it.
Agree? Disagree?
No, agree. Yeah. Yeah. I think it's not to phrase Fight Club, but you know, he will have the best breakfast the next day that we'll never know what it's going to be like. Yeah. I think when you become used to things and things are at your disposal, as you were saying, it's just the civilization kind of becomes just you take things for granted. And I think when something happens, you know, hopefully it's not bad, but something kind of jolts you, it gives you perspective, you know, something in life, and it makes you sort of appreciate like, oh wow, like maybe I should, you know, you look at things a little differently. And I think when you get that jolt or that shock, especially when it's in like a game with a bunch of people or a theater with a bunch of people, you're all experiencing that together. And that sort of that rush, that adrenaline, I feel like sort of gives you that a little bit of that taste. And so I think people really like to hold on to that.
Yeah. And there's always a what if in life. I know people say you shouldn't live in the what if, but I'm genuinely a curious person. I'm interested in everything. I'm interested in going to a music concert for a band that I know nothing about because I'm just interested and curious. And I think the what if of what we're interested in and what we're talking about here is very interesting, right? To just keep your mind engaged and jolted and you know, and sort of prepared for, like Alec said and Taylor, like prepared for life, you know, because that is sort of how life is. Life is not just this same sort of roller coaster ride every time. It's like a ride that just keeps going and breaks down and falls off the tracks and someone gets ejected out of the side. You know, that's just you. I think that's what makes it so exciting, you know?
That's why in the game I'd be the first to be killed down that hallway and not try to figure it out first. I would just be annihilated.
Oh, everybody does. Yeah.
Glen, you're clearly a huge horror fan. Why do you like being scared?
So I definitely thought about this a lot, because always trying to think of the emotional aspect of the player. I've got a few little things. One is it's like a roller coaster, right? We don't experience it every day. And the roller coaster is click, click, click. That's like that tension. And then that's the jump scare, right? And people want that, right? We don't get that in our real life. When was the last time you were scared? Right. Maybe somebody like got you and you got a jump scare, but people go in prepared. Right. And I also think that there's a badge of honor. Like, some of them come out and they go, scared the crap out of me. You know, and they're like, you got me. And, or didn't get me or whatever. So there's a, hey, I'm prepared for the challenge of this thing.
Yeah.
And you guys talked about adrenaline. Absolutely believe that. Yeah, it's like an adrenaline rush. It's it's just an emotion that we don't deal with every day.
Yeah,
and it's an escape.
It's funny because I was on a roller coaster and there was someone got there. Their kid just met the line of like getting onto the coaster.
Right,
and so they sat in and he was like behind us. And he was crying like as it was cranking. And then he was screaming as it was going down. And then I was going up, he started laughing.
Okay.
Right.
And you're just
so
like,
so many, oh, yeah, dang. Yeah.
He's just like, what's happening?
Some people laugh after they get scared. Like, holy.
Yeah. 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 God, it's true. You know? Yeah. It's true.
That is a good point, actually. It's a big different range of emotions. Some huge. People are excited they just got scared. Other people are like, oh no, I'm done.
Yeah.
Okay, now that we've experienced the brutality and atmosphere of Black Iron Prison and learned about the helplessness and humanity that the castle experienced, the moment is finally here. We've been teasing the world premiere of the Callisto Protocol launch trailer all show long. So without further ado, please enjoy.
An outbreak. Why is it all? They killed everyone. Trying to contain it. Everyone. All of my nightmares
are coming to you. Do what you gotta do in here. This place is a way of changing you.
Bad stuff happened here.
No.
I know who you are. I know what you did.
Can't keep running from what you've done. Now let's go finish this.
There you have it, the premiere of the launch trailer for Callisto Protocol. Pretty good stuff. I'm super excited for this game. Alec, what'd you think?
Oh my God. I was just flashing back to my childhood when I was watching Toho movies and so, and thinking, why don't they ever do handheld cameras with monsters, right? And now, flash forward to this. Great work, man.
Thank you.
Gorgeous.
It's really exciting. It looks beautiful. It draws you in, and then
It has a little bit too for me, like the 80s when I was a kid, those movies that I loved so much that had like space and scary, and I really have that nostalgic to those kind of things. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. Very cool. Glen, how does that trailer hit on the elements of horror that we've been discussing so far? Brutality, atmosphere, helplessness, humanity.
Yeah, well, We showed a little less of the brutality because we've shown a lot.
Sure.
We wanted to give a little bit more of the humanity, some of the, a little more of the characters, little tiny bits of story, at least that you know, oh, there's a story there because they're talking about a mystery, that sort of thing. And we wanted to show that it's not just pure horror all the time. There's some action-y horror, you know. There's some action moments, and there's a lot to do in the game. It's a long game, you know, like I said, which is good. So you've got to change it up, and that's what this trailer is designed to do, is to show there's more to it.
I definitely got that sense from it. For all the people out there that are excited for Callisto Protocol, are there any new sort of like gameplay details that are in this trailer that we hadn't seen before?
I think I talked about a little bit with the story, and there's more things to do than meets the eye, and you said something I wanted to mention you said beautiful, and you kind of want the world to be beautiful in its own way, right?
Yeah,
it's a weird word, but it kind of needs to be, you know.
Agreed. Yeah, it struck me as like there's a dance to everything that's happening there too, right? And then it comes back to that like yin yang of like the tension, the tug and the, you know,
yep,
push and the pull of it all. Yep. Yeah, it's
especially with that, when the song playing and the emotion,
yeah,
it really played to me like so much, like you said, it grounded it with a bit of this humanity feeling.
Oh, that's good. You know what? That's You like the song. I mean, it's different. It's haunting. That's what we want to go with. Me too.
Yeah.
You have to put the, like the first parts of the trailer, the first time that we did it, we're like, oh, it doesn't go with the music. It's got to go with the music. Yeah. The music's dictating what the trailer needs to be as well.
Yeah.
And it fits. It fits for me.
I really enjoyed it. It really struck me. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was done by Kings Elliot just for that trailer. Wow. And it's so, so haunting. And that's where you have to do the visuals around the song.
Yeah. Yeah, it really lands too, because you're just expecting something horrific, and instead it sort of makes you get all like, the chills.
Yeah, you start with the snow, and you hear the voice, her voice. It's just, it's beautiful.
That's great to hear from you guys. Thank you. Thank you.
So, Glenn, in the trailer, we got a better look at Josh Duhamel and Karen Fukuhara's characters. What was the intention behind featuring them more prominently this time?
Well, we talked about humanity. And, part of it is we wanted to show a little bit more of the humanity and touch upon that there is a rich story there. And so we gave glimpses of it, and, they were so great to work with, and they did an awesome job. So I think it was important that we show some of their, what they did on screen for us.
Well, unfortunately, that is all the time we have left. I want to give a huge thank you to Alec Gillis, Andy Grush, Taylor Stewart, and Glenn Schofield for taking the time to break down the elements of my favorite genre. And another thank you to the horror engineers over at Striking Distance Studios for your hard work. The Callisto Protocol is coming to PlayStation, Xbox, and PC platforms on December 2nd. For more on all things gaming, stay tuned to IGN.
Come on!